one thing came the next, and this is why I'm at this moment I'm here. And when we talk about gentrification, because that was the issue actually, what does it mean towards healthcare? And
dear Mr. President, I'm writing to complain about a recent journey I suffered at the hands of your company. I would like to strongly recommend that you read this letter carefully and supply me with a committed response, as I am appalled and offended at the treatment and conditions I faced as a customer of your staff and facility.
Well, first of all, let's start with how I got here. Because yesterday morning, Peter here called me that he was talking with Patrick, one of the organizers, and there was already an idea to invite me here to talk about healthcare. And from one thing came the next, and this is why I'm at this moment I'm here. And when we talk about gentrification, because that was the issue actually, what does it mean towards healthcare?
Sorry, this is a little bit similar like Christiania, no, right? In Denmark.
You can see that gentrification is a big issue in healthcare in general. You can see that health in itself is something that becomes more and more only affordable to people who have enough money, right? Healthcare in itself becomes more expensive, but it also becomes less accessible. The kind of healthcare that is accessible is usually not sufficient to become healthy or to keep your health, right? So this is one of the main issues. You see it not only in healthcare, you see it also in sports, you see it in beauty treatment and all kind of other things. And I'm specialized in Chinese medicine and sports, and then you see in Chinese medicine and sports that these things like sports, taking care of your looks, and medicine and health, these are all one unified whole. There's no real separation between them. And so the boundaries are very vague, you can say, if there's any boundaries. And in general, there is the idea that they should be unified to be able to give you as a person the opportunity to take care of your health, right? So when you look at these kind of things, you see that there's a development going on. First of all, modern medicine and modern healthcare is not very old, as you probably know. Modern healthcare started somewhere in the 19th century, and at a certain point they had a legal victory over alternative medicine, what is now called alternative medicine, but what used to be called medicine. And they were basically banned from the official story about healthcare. And people were not allowed to take or to use self-medication. Which is still, of course, an issue for a lot of different kinds of things. And self-medication, we talk, in Western perspective, we talk about medicines, right? And from the Chinese medicine perspective, you can say, okay, the first line medication is, there's Morton. The first line of medication is...
This is the place where I'm going to give my lecture today.
I walked outside one day and a man was standing there. He had a great big beard and lots of hair. He said, won't you come down to the shore and join my jolly crew? We'll wander around the world beneath the skies of blue. We'll sail upon the seven seas, travel
near our daily food. That's medication, right? Because with taking food, every day you have an influence on your health. So whatever you put into your mouth, it has an effect on your body. And everything that you take regularly in your body, that's come back to your question before about marijuana also. Yeah. Everything that you take regularly in your body has a regular effect on your body, and that impacts the chemistry of your body. So from a scientific perspective, you can say that whatever you put in your mouth regularly affects you, and it makes you dependent. So if you eat everyday bread, you will be bread dependent. If you eat rice, you will become rice dependent. If you smoke marijuana, you will become marijuana dependent, because your body at a certain point, and it's usually after 3 months, thinks this is normal for the chemistry of your body. So your body then at that moment starts stopping doing the things to produce the substances that the chemistry that you put into your body already makes. A nice example is nicotine in cigarettes. Your body makes nicotine. If you don't produce nicotine, you can't have any power in your body. So it's very easy. But if you take a cigarette, one cigarette has already 10 times the doses that your body makes. So over the day, you're overdosing yourself continuously on nicotine. And that's the reason why when you start smoking, you feel, you know, very clear and very strong. But when you keep on smoking, you start feeling tired and nervous and neurotic and so on. Yeah, so this is basically what happens at that moment. And with marijuana, it's the same. The chemistry of marijuana works so very well with for people because we already make these substances in our body, which allows us to have a particular kind of development in our mind, in our emotions and stuff. But at the moment when you use it on a regular basis, your body stops doing that because it's already taken care of. Why would the body make anything that's already been taken care of? But you always overdose, right? So every time when you take anything, even if you take a coffee with sugar, you overdose immediately because caffeine also is being made in some form. There is something being made in your body that is already there. But healthcare doesn't stop. Yeah.
Are you going to talk about medicine? Or
no, this is just my introduction.
Pharmaceuticals.
This is just my introduction.
Sorry?
This is just my introduction at this moment. This is just my introduction at this moment.
My introduction.
Yeah. Yeah, so.
I would like if you talk a bit louder if you can.
I'll try.
I'll move closer.
Yeah, you sat here.
Yeah, I thought actually I go and lay down here. That is maybe the handiest.
Whatever.
Is this yours?
So what happens
yes, cool.
with people, with our modern societies, is that we take food as a fuel for our body. So we take food and we think, okay, we empower ourselves by eating. And we do that in a way which compares the way how we take food with the way how we put gasoline into a car, right? So we're mechanizing our body. And if you put fuel in it, it doesn't really matter what you put in it, as long as it has variation, then everything in general will be okay. But on the long term, you can have a lot of influences on your health by the choice of foods that you take. For instance, if you would take a diet with only peanuts, you will notice that you will die very quickly. And anything very healthy, for instance, there's all these fashions with superfoods. If you take any of these ingredients very often, within a few weeks' time, you will be sick. Yes, because there's no thing such as superfoods. But there is a smart selection of what you take and what you do not take. And at the moment when you get sick, you can say medication should be an addition to your diet. And you should not start thinking from a health perspective, like you have your food and you have medication, right? Because you put it in your mouth, so it is food, right? So anything you put in your mouth is food, whether it's a cigarette, whether it's Wurst's, whether it's a sandwich or whether it's Prozac or anything like that, it's all food. So you nourish yourself like that in a particular kind of way. And we all know the saying, you are what you eat. You are what you eat is a saying that is used both in the East and in the West. So if you eat a lot of apples, you become apple-ish. If you eat a lot of chicken, you become chicken-ish. And the concepts of Chinese medicine, accidentally, they are based on this thing. You have a particular kind of qi, they say in Chinese medicine. And then that qi is who you are. And it's the form of your body, but it's also the form of your personality and your behavior at the same time. And your personal development, your spirituality, all these kind of things, they are dependent on the qi that you produce. And your food is one part of how you produce this. But at the moment when you look at modern Western societies, you see that health in general is owned. Yes? But not by you as a person, but by law, by economics, and so forth and so forth. And this is actually where is the issue about this lecture. Because my idea from where I work usually is that there should be a healthcare which is low cost, low tech, and so on and so forth, so that every person, say from birth already, starts being educated by their parents or even by school or whatever kind of institutions that are available, so that they can understand what is the language of health and what is the action of health at the same time. Right, so there's particular kind of things that are helpful for that purpose.
Look over there.
Mr. Mayor.
What is that?
Yes.
A horse.
Yeah. The other fellow.
Looks like he's got a horn.
It's a unicorn.
But he's so shiny.
He's a robot.
A robotic unicorn? What's he doing?
I don't know.
He's going after that person. He's gonna poke him with his horn.
You don't need the first aid to open.
The food is one. But the way how you move is also important. It's not important that you move. It's important that you move, of course. But it's also important how you move. Yeah, because you can walk like a potato bag over the street, but it doesn't mean that it's going to make you stronger or make you better. Because you have to realize also what your life is for. And it doesn't really matter if you believe in heaven or you believe in hell or you believe in nothing after death, but your life eventually moves towards an end. But what you believe determines also how you end, right? I don't know about you, what you believe in, but from the Chinese medicine perspective, they say it is normal to become 1,000 years old, right? So that's very different from here, because here we have a statistical belief. We say, on average, people become between 60 and 80 years old, right? And because we become between 60 and 80 years old, all our expectations are based on that, and we only have to manage to get there, and then we can be released. You understand? If I do interviews with elderly people, I'm now over 50 and I talk more with people over 50. And then at that moment, you start hearing more and more often, to become 1,000 years old? No. I'm going to be happy if it's finished. Yes? And that's the way how we live. We are living as if life is a punishment. You understand? Mm. And because we live life as a punishment, at that moment, you see that there is a certain kind of misery which we accept, and then as a result of that, we are also exploitable. Why? Because if there is a misery, there are always people who are going to offer you something with a promise that it's going to be better. Right? So healthcare, in that sense, is supposed to help you to become as much independent in your health as possible so that you are not exploitable. Right? So you develop a certain kind of autonomy in relationship to your health and to other people. And then at that moment, from the freedom of being healthy, you can make a choice what you want to add to it or not want to add to it. Like when you talk about marijuana, when you're healthy, you're fit, you're capable, and you take here marijuana, it has a different kind of effect than when you're weak or you're sick or you're psychologically confused or anything like that. You understand? So by taking these kind of choices away from people, you also take away the awareness of what things do. As far as Chinese medicine is concerned, if you would divide health, you would say there is things you can do in your daily life by the choices of food and the way how you move. But the way how you move is not determined by just a choice by saying, okay, we want to walk with a straight back because that is healthier, because then all the organs get more space. But you want to develop the kind of muscles that create that space. But if you go to a gym, you do strength exercises and cardio, and the cardio exhausts your body, makes your body very hot so that you age faster, right? And you do the strength exercise so that your bones are more tight, so that the chance for a hernia or other back problems is higher. And also your muscles, they are ripped and they are acidified, so that the chance for dementia is higher, right? So all kind of things happen to your body. But if you don't do anything, you get the same problems. Right? You don't exercise also. So that means that the way how you exercise determines what's going to happen. So things like Kung Fu, Neigong, Qigong, meditation, yoga, and so forth, they serve to help you to create the right kind of shape of your body, the right kind of form and space in your body, so that the chemistry can optimize itself. And that in itself has a new effect. One of the things is that you need less food. Yes? Your mind is usually more happy. So that you feel comfortable and you feel like, today is a nice day. I'm going to get up immediately from my bed and I don't need to first wait for 1 hour until I feel ready to get out of my bed. Anybody knows this problem? That you feel in the morning like, I really don't want to get up?
I made a poem about it.
Okay, very good. I like to hear about that.
Thank you.
And so the exercisement of your body is very important. And then you have to realize, what is there to be exercised? So this is, first of all, is the form of your body. So that's like a basic thing, like how do you shape your body in such a way that it feels comfortable with being there? if it feels comfortable with being there, then at that moment for your mind there is a particular kind of comfort and pleasure in your daily life through which you enjoy doing things more, but also through which you enjoy doing constructive things anymore. And if you do counterproductive, counterconstructive things, you start realizing like, my body doesn't feel nice with that. So your body becomes like a mirror. It becomes like a mirror. Because your mind and your body, of course, they are intertwined with each other in a way that allows your mind to notice particular kind of things. Like, for instance, I already don't take drugs for a long time, but I remember every time when I take drugs, my body starts, you know, sloping. Doesn't really matter what kind of drugs, even when I would take speed, in a particular kind of way, my body would start sloping and it doesn't feel really comfortable. But I didn't realize it at that time because I was used to it. And I thought it was normal because memory doesn't go very far. Right? Right now, because I'm used to hold my body open, when my body starts doing this, I start noticing my body really uncomfortable because it becomes stuffy. You understand? Becomes stuffy. And at the moment when it becomes stuffy, my mind becomes stuffy too. Yes? Maybe that's particular for me, but I also see it in people who follow classes and they start noticing like, oh, my body is open, I feel more comfortable. But I also feel more comfortable to make particular kind of choices which help my health in general forward. Right? And then there's particular kind of things that you see which are important. Like, for instance, balance is important. Strength is important. Agility is important. Flexibility is important. And there's a whole range of things that you can do to improve your qualities. Speed, for instance, is important, but slowness is also important. And patience is also important. And discipline is also important. And so these are all parts that all play a role. And there's a particular set of nowadays popular exercises. It's called planking. You know about that? Planking. They stand like this on their knees and on their elbows and they are on their feet and they have to hold on for that for 5 minutes or something, 10 minutes. And it's supposed to tone the muscles. But in Kung Fu practice, you stand like this. I'll do it here because it's easier. And you stand like this on your fingertips, like this, and you have to hold on for an hour. Because at that moment, when you do that for a longer time, your mind, your body, the chemistry of your body, they start changing and you start challenging the system as it happens as a result of bad habits, and it eventually starts creating useful habits that are based on endurance, which is not comfortable the first time that you do it, don't worry. Yes, I have a very few students who can hold on for longer than 10-15 minutes. Yes, because it is really very hard if you don't exercise all the other aspects of your body too. Right? So you see there's a hierarchy in your health. And then you start noticing that health can be based on, they already mentioned that they were going to leave, so yeah, you're welcome. Then you see that health has a sort of hierarchy, and this hierarchy leads eventually to the realization that health is not based on the fact that you're alive, but on the ideal of how long you should be able to live and under what conditions, right? And then from Chinese medicine perspective specifically, they say idealism is the root of all science.
The root
of all science.
All science.
Right? And in our modern science, they say, well, statistical observation is the root of all science. And so this statistical observation is what we commonly see. And then there's exceptions, but, you know, these are just exceptions. Yes? So this is where it's a very important main difference. After I stopped taking drugs and I started exercising, at a certain point I went back to university. I got an opportunity to go back to university and study, and I chose to live for 50 years in a monastic community to understand how in China Chinese medicine used to be used. And the irony is that China is of course a post-cultural revolution. And the Cultural Revolution has destroyed, maybe 99% of everything, old culture. And old people were forbidden to talk about the old culture, so the old people didn't teach the young generations how to improve. And I was just on the cusp when, in the first few years that I was there, between that people realized there was a new freedom, so they could start doing things. And up to this day, though, they complain that the old generations, they don't explain about what happened before the Cultural Revolution, what was actually being taught. They have the books, but they don't know what they mean, right? So they can reconstruct things, but there is no understanding of the meaning. And these old people, they were willing to talk to me as a foreigner, because it was very unlikely that as a foreigner I would work for the Communist Party, right? So some of my brothers in the monastic community that I was part of, they complained that they couldn't learn with the same people that I was learning with, because very simply they wouldn't talk to them, because they were all considered agents from the Communist Party. So that's very difficult. And you see this in many cultures all over the world, that the appropriation of the original culture has been taken away for one reason or another, whether it's legal, whether it's political, whether it's economic, and so forth and so forth. And this is the issue that you face every day at the moment when you're trying to develop your health. You're walking against a barrier which is either legal or it's economic or a combination of both, or in some cases even political.
Oh, okay. Van de Broedsplaats.
Resort.
Okay. This tree is great. It has changed a lot since last time I was here.
In our society, the political barriers, they are not, well, they are there, but they are not really that strong. But they are there. But the economic barriers are very high. Because, for instance, to start a community where people can practice health, you need to have a space which is highly expensive, because it's owned by people who charge very high rents. So that means already that your healthcare becomes expensive just because of your rent. You understand? So this is a really big issue for a lot of different kind of things. And then when you go to a school where you learn about these kind of things, usually you're being taught to set up your own, basically, business, right? So everybody is just doing business. And as a result of that, they're competing with each other instead of cooperating with each other. And if you want to set up a real good system of healthcare, you have to have cooperation. The cooperation has two parts, because it has providers and it has users. But to make it financially viable and useful, both the users and the producers, they have to co-own the healthcare. Because for proper healthcare, you as a person, you have to be at least partly producer of your health. You cannot leave your health only to other people. But just taking vitamins, for instance, or just running in the park is not going to do it. In fact, research shows that people who frequently run, they live 10% shorter than people who never run. Yes? They live 10% shorter than people who never run. That's a lot.
Yeah.
That's a lot, right?
She runs.
So there you go. Yeah. And that doesn't mean that there's no people who do not grow very old and they cannot run for a long time. For instance, I lived for a while in Shanghai, and there was a park close by my house. There was this guy, he was like 88, and he was running and he was boxing and stuff like this, but he was an exception. Yeah? Most people, they stop running when they're like 50, 60 years old, because they can't handle it anymore. And our modern sports is also based on the principle, you have to make an achievement, and everything in life is like that. You have to make an achievement, you have to peak, and after that it's all going downhill. It doesn't really matter, because you have done that thing. You have done this peaking, and at that moment the rest is just memories, right? Sports people in general, you know that most people, they can't go any further than 40 years old. Well, in fact, you should peak just before you die. And I don't say you're going to be able to become 1,000 years old, but you should be able to manage your life in such a way, your health in such a life, that the best qualities are just before you die. And you can't start with that when you're 40. Yeah, you can start with it when you're 40, but you're not going to make it until 1,000 years old at that moment. It's very unlikely, maybe 150. Yeah. Or you can wait until the industry is far enough to offer you a very expensive product that artificially gets you there, with all the misery of somebody who has never done anything for their health. Yeah, because then, of course, the artificiality, they also have to take something away, and they will have to brand you in a particular kind of way, otherwise they can't provide you new things. It's the same, like I have this phone through which I make the recordings for my vlog. Yes, but at the same time, the phone becomes more and more expensive because of all the apps that are in there, and that you need to actually make things look professionally. So your editing programs, they're already going to make you go broke at some point. Yes, because everybody charges something every month. And that's for your health is exactly the same. The more you depend on artificial interference, the more likely you are to be continuously paying and always be behind on your health. If you look at modern education and healthcare, there is schools that are being developed for health maintenance based on Western medicine. And it's based on the idea that already when you're like 13, 14 years old, you should start with medications to maintain your health. So that you're continuously medicated, and that means that you have a continuous dependency also at the same time. And even if you exercise, then at that moment this dependency then is always going to be in the background of your body, and that you need to make enough money to be able to afford it, right? So this is basically the core issue of my talk. I actually made a lot of notes, and I have the habit of moving away from things. There's a lot of things I already heard this morning. But in general, I've done these things. I've said almost everything that I had in here. Some details I left out.